morning and welcome to Hampton Presbyterian Church. I'm so glad that you could be here with us this morning. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds for a rich encounter with the risen Lord Jesus Christ.
Stand and call ourselves to worship with the words that are printed in the bulletin. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts.
Thank you.
We sing such a powerful song as we start out this time of worship. And we recognize the provision that God has given to us, which is absolutely stunning. It throws us into a posture of, who am I to deserve such great, marvelous gifts that God has given? For we recognize our own brokenness as we stand before His holiness. We acknowledge the reality that there are things that we have done that we wish we wouldn't have done. Yet as a body of Christ, we can gather together and we confess these sins before the presence of the Lord God Almighty, who is faithful, who loves us without measure, and cares deeply for us. So let us join our voices together in reciting this prayer of confession as found in the bulletin. Eternal God, in every age you have raised up men and women to live and die in faith. We confess that we are indifferent to your will. You call to us to proclaim your name, but we are silent. You call us to do what is just, but we remain idle. You call us to live faithfully, but we are afraid. In your mercy, forgive us. Give us courage to follow in your way, that joined with those from ages past who have served you with faith, hope, and love, we may inherit the kingdom you promised in Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, friends, there is good news that abounds, and the good news is rooted in Jesus Christ, who is assured for us, even as the psalmist writes, as far as the east is from the west, so far the Lord removes our transgressions from us, and we have been forgiven. Let us give thanks to God. You may be seated. Ryan has selected an absolutely stellar passage for his New Testament lesson, 7 to 1 Timothy chapter 3, 1 to 5. This is good news for all of us, challenging words as well, as our dear friend and apostle Paul encourages his young son in the faith, who has leadership of a dear church, to give good instruction, which applies to us even today. Hear now God's word. Here is a trustworthy saying. If anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. Now the overseer must be above reproach, the husband of but one wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him with proper respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Old Testament lesson this morning comes from the book of 1 Samuel. We're looking at chapter 2, and we're looking at verses 12 through 21. So I encourage you to check out the other sides of this, especially if you go back to the beginning of chapter 2 in your own time. You can see a lovely prayer that Hannah prays that happens before this and kind of the rest of the story that follows. But right now we pick up 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 12 through 21, page 421 of your Pew Bible. Let us listen to the word of the Lord as it talks about the high priest Eli, his sons. Eli's sons were wicked men. They had no regard for the Lord. Now it was the practice of the priests with the people that whenever anyone offered a sacrifice, and while the meat was being boiled, the servant of the priest would come with a three-pronged fork in his hand. He would plunge it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot, and the priest would take for himself whatever the fork brought up. This is how they treated all the Israelites who came to Shiloh. But even before the fat was burned, the servant of the priest would come and say to the man who was sacrificing, "Give the priest some of the meat to roast. He won't accept boiled meat from you, but only raw." If the man said to him, "Let the fat be burned first, and then whatever you want," the servant would then answer, "No, hand it over now. If you don't, I'll take it by force." This sin of the young men was great in the Lord's sight, for they were treating the Lord's offering with contempt, and that being Eli's sons they're talking about there. But Samuel was ministering before the Lord, a boy wearing a linen ephod. Each year his mother made him a little robe and took it to him when she went up with her husband to offer the annual sacrifice. Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife, saying, "May the Lord give you children by this woman to take the place of the one she prayed for and gave to the Lord," that being Samuel. Then they would go home, and the Lord was gracious to Hannah. She conceived and gave birth to three sons and two daughters. Meanwhile, the boy Samuel grew up in the presence of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. God, we thank you for this chance to be in your house and for the scripture that was read. God, we ask that as we're here in your house, that your spirit would be stirring among us, that it would be opening our ears and our eyes, our hearts and our minds, so that the word of scripture was read would sink into our hearts. And as I'm saying the words in the sermon, God, may it not be my words that people hear, but your words speaking through me, so that together we might glorify you this day. We pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. So we've been going through this series on the theodicy, and we've gotten to families today. And I thought it would be a good thing as we started off this sermon on families to spend some time remembering and reflecting on this question. What is a fond memory you have connected to your family? Now, this might be when you were little. This might be the family that you've raised when you're older. It might be a vacation or a holiday or just some sort of special event. I want you to take a moment to think of a memory. Well, as I was thinking about this, there's obviously a ton of different memories that came to mind as I was thinking about it, but I chose not to talk about a vacation or a holiday, sort of, but I chose to think of a time with my grandfather. So what would happen every Christmas, it seemed, we would come down to Pittsburgh, where my grandparents lived, in Moon Township, and we would get to spend that Christmas season with them. Well, I was about 10 when this happened, and I was down here, and we got one of those big snows that can happen in Pittsburgh. And so a call came to my grandfather that the parking lot of the church was just covered, and the sidewalks and everything else, and they needed someone to come clear the snow. And so my grandfather brought me and my 7-year-old brother over, and I don't know how long we spent clearing snow, and it was hard work. But it was really good and satisfying work, because what we saw modeled was my grandfather serving behind the scenes in the church to help so people would be able to get in to worship. And so I felt like I was part of this significant work. I was getting trained into how do you serve the church. Well, isn't that the reality that's what families should be, right? They should be this place where it's a safe place, where training is happening, where people are learning how to use their gifts and their talents and all of that stuff. It should be a nurturing and loving environment, right? Where people get to learn about themselves in the context of that family so that they're ready to go out into the world as their own people and then to be able to start their own families, right? The context of where families comes from, Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, talks about a man leaving his father and mother and be uniting to his wife, and they become one flesh. They get to start their own family. Wouldn't it be great if it ends there and we just think about all the happy memories of family? Unfortunately, the reality is it does start here at marriage, and I think you could ask anyone that has just gotten married, right? They go in with the best intentions. They hope that it's going to be a great family that's full of blessings for years to come. We see broken families, right? We see family rate of divorce is just under 50%. We know that there are kids that are estranged from their parents, whether it be the kids' fault or the parents' fault, probably both are to blame. We know that there is mental health issues that cause some of this. We know that there's even abuse that causes some of this. I could probably go on for like the next few hours if I was talking about all of the different things that are wrong with families and what God would want to do. But I thought, okay, I can't actually do that. We won't have time for that. And so I wanted to just focus on this one thing that I think is crucial for families, and it's how can we raise the next generation? What happens in this training of the kids, right? And that's exactly what we know God cares deeply about, right? Because I had Ted read 1 Timothy. Now, this is just verses 4 and 5 up here to highlight, but you heard the beginning before this. Right? He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him with proper respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's family? Well, the reality is that this is written for what we would probably call elders in the Presbyterian Church. And just shortly after this, he pretty much says the same thing about deacons, i.e., if you are going to be a leader in the church, men and women, this applies to you. How are you participating in this raising of the next generation? Is it going well? Is it going bad? Hopefully it's going well, because how your own nuclear family is being raised is going to reflect how you're helping raise people in the church. And so we see that God says, hey, this is important to think about the next generation. And we even have another verse that I think everyone thinks of when they think about raising children. You might even be able to guess this proverb ahead of time. You've probably seen maybe even a poster or a throw pillow with it. And it's this one. Start children off on the way they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it, right? I'm sure that you've seen Proverbs 22:6 at some point in time. Well, the reality is, I think we've misunderstood this verse some. And actually, Ted and I had a fun time this week, or it might have been last week, where I said, hey, Ted, I'm thinking about using this verse, But I read this article that says it could be completely different. Can you go back to the Hebrew with me and tell me what it's actually saying? And so we got to do this whole study on it. And the conclusion was it's indecisive exactly how you should do it. But the reality is it's much more than just this phrase that we have up here. The reality is in the context of this verse, there are three other proverbs that are warnings. But you don't see a warning here, right? When you read this, it seems just like a promise that people rely on. Like, if I bring my kid to church and I teach him about Jesus, everything will be perfect. They're obviously going to follow that the next years and years and years and years to come. And then they get disappointed when that doesn't happen because they're just relying on this promise. Now, I am not saying, do not hear me saying that it is not important to bring kids into church, to have them understand the stories that are taught, to spend time getting them to understand the Word of God. I think that greatly helps with the next thing. But I think as we look at this verse, we realize there's more to just telling them the stories that needs to happen. There has to be some extreme intentionality when we think about raising the next generation. And I've been talking, and you know, some people out there might be thinking, hey, I'm off the hook, right? I don't have any young kids anymore. I might have not even had kids. Well, here's the reality, right? We do baptisms. And actually, I love this picture, and I didn't even realize it until I'd actually found this picture. But you've got the mom and dad up there. That's the Temples and their daughter, Abby, that I got to baptize. And the reality is, on Abby's baptism, a promise was made here by the congregation that you were going to help in the raising of Abby. And so I love that their friend is actually standing up there with them, almost as a representative of each one of you. Because when we have a baptism, we put the challenge out there to get to know five names of kids in this church. And I'll say, I'll even give you the pass. That can be five kids in your neighborhood if you don't want it to just be kids at church. Who are the people, the kids, that God has put in your life? So all of you can think about raising this next generation. And I am a firm believer that the church moms, dads, aunts, uncles, grandparents are very important. And I know it firsthand. I had a lot of church grandmas praying for me when I was growing up. And you can ask my mom, those prayers were heard because there was a lot of praying that she asked them to do for me. Well, as we get into this Old Testament lesson that we've been talking about, there's this image that we have here. And so you've got Eli's sons up there. And essentially what they're doing is completely going against the laws of the sacrifices. You realize they didn't care what the laws were. They were undisciplined. They even get called wicked in the scripture that we were reading. They were living for their own pleasure and doing whatever they wanted. And so there were some consequences that came because Eli hadn't really told them, hey, you've got to live this way, and tried to bring correction into life. He just let them live the way that they wanted. And so as you follow in the next few verses, it's actually really sad as there are some very harsh consequences that happen. So as I was thinking about Eli and the model that he was using to raise kids, I, of course, started thinking about, well, what are the models that we use? And I realized that happiness ends up being a really important thing. We say we want our kids to be happy, and I think we live into two different models. Maybe these are a bit extreme as we're doing it. The one on your right, you can see, the mom is just sitting there letting the kids do whatever might make them happy, whether it's tie her up or play with the soccer ball inside or doing any of that. There's no correction that's happening. It's almost this hands-off approach. The one on the left is a mom, and if you can't read what it says, Mom, we want to sell the lemonade. And it's pointing out this reality of helicopter parenting, where the mom or the dad is doing everything for the kid. And as we look at these two models that focus on, hey, I want my kid to be happy, we can see where there is fault in both of them. On the one on the right, if there's no discipline, they're not going to learn. They're just going to be focused on their own pleasure, and that's going to lead to ruin. Our verse that we pointed out from Proverbs 22:6, right? They're going to just live into that way the rest of their lives, just like Eli's sons. Or if it's on the left, it's like you're giving them these training wheels, and they're never learning how to live on their own because all the decisions are being made for them, so there's no consequences if you're living your life for your kid, focused solely on happiness. Well, the good thing for us is that we've got a great model in Hannah, who does something different with Samuel. Instead of it being focused on Samuel's happiness, it's focused on teaching Samuel about God, right? How can Samuel learn to live and walk in the ways of the Lord? And she does something pretty extreme. She ends up dedicating Samuel to the Lord. So she has literally left Samuel at the temple, and he is going to get raised at the temple. Now, what sometimes happens that I don't think is good is we can shove off parenting to the church. And that's not what I'm saying here. It's not like she just said, okay, temple, you can take care of raising Samuel all on your own. No, she does this with some intentionality. And we see that she visits Samuel and keeps checking in on him and is praying for him consistently. When she makes the main focus, how can I teach him about the Lord and to walk in these ways and not happiness, what hopefully will happen and he'll experience that I know to be true is that he's going to understand something far greater than happiness when he starts understanding the joy that can come from following the Lord. And so here's the reality that we learn from Hannah. We need to be intentional. We need to be able to think about the future. We need to be people that are going to come alongside our kids, understand the gifts and the passions that they have, and then walk alongside them, not making all the decisions for them, but supporting them as they go through life. And if they make a decision where they fall down, we're right there to help them back up and get back on their feet so they can continue going, so that they learn what it is to walk in the ways of the Lord. We need to, as Hannah did, view our kids as the gift from God that they are. So hold it in your hands, but hold it with open hands so that God can be active in their life. And then the reality that will happen is they'll be trained up. They'll become leaders, even now in the church, before they're old. And then they'll be the leaders who are going to be training the next generation as they get older. And so we've thought about this idea of training, and as I was thinking about it, I think there's two questions that are left to be asked as we're learning about how to shape this training and how to engage in it. And the first question is, what is your family's history, the good and the bad? And the second question, what traits do I want to define my family? If you remember the Ten Commandments, you might have just glossed over this part of the Ten Commandments when we just go through and we try to list the ten. But this is found just verse 5 and 6. I think it's right after the idol. Don't make idol one. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of their parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. And then you read that and you go, uh-oh, that's not good. But then you keep reading, but showing love to the thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commands. Here's the reality. We both have bad and good. And that bad and good defines us. But it's what do we do with this bad and good that's going to show how God's going to use it. And so if I was thinking about some of the good that happened to me from generation to generation, I think back to my great-grandparents who were active in the church. I don't know if they were elders necessarily, but there's even this article written by a pastor about my great-grandfather and how he was trying to equip the church because he was responding to that. And then if you've got to meet my grandmother, you would have known that she was very active in her church in Sharon and then in Swickley when she moved to Swickley, responding to God's call, along with my grandfather that I already shared about. My mom has been an elder and a deacon and has responded to say, God, use me in the ways that I can to help the church. And then there's me. As I saw all of this modeled and kind of the legacy that was happening, when God said, okay, go to seminary, I said, well, I've already seen how this works, God. I'm going to go to seminary. I'm going to say yes to this call that you've put on my life. And my hope is that my daughters would also be able to respond to this call. That legacy that's lived into as people have said, yes, God, use me. I'm open to how you want to use me. The reality is there's also some bad in my life. If you have met my mom or you've heard my story, you know that when I was young, my parents got divorced. And so there was brokenness that was in our family. But the reality is that both my mom and my dad, I said, you know what? I don't want divorce to happen to the next thing. I don't want my kids to experience divorce. And so they have spent years praying for me and my brother and our marriages. They have been invested. They have encouraged us to ask hard questions and to make sure that we do things like counseling if we need counseling, to be intentional about our marriage and not just let it be something that goes by the wayside that we don't put any effort into. And because they've done that, I think I've got a pretty good marriage. Is it perfect? No. I mean, Debbie could tell you that I'm not perfect. But we're both committed to living out that marriage in a way that we want our daughters to see for their marriages that they hopefully happen. And then the last question was, what traits do you want to define your family? Obviously, growing up was summer's best 2 weeks. The first answer, but I thought I'm going to give this, and then I've got to give another one because it's kind of a cop-out sort of answer, is obviously I want my kids to follow the I'm third motto. God first, others second, and I'm third. That's been huge for me, and so I'm trying to pass it on to them. But as I thought about it, one that's actually sometimes hard for Debbie and I is one that we want to see modeled in our kids, and that's generosity, right? We know how much you've been given by God, and sometimes it's not easy to just completely give back to God out of everything or trust that God is going to continue to provide as you give back. But it's something that we're trying to live into, and I know that it's started to live into our daughters, as even when Sarah was 2.5 years old, or maybe 2, we had a group of people over for like a special meal thing, and Sarah was there, and what did she do? She knew that when people come over, you should give them a toy so they have something to play with. And so she went and grabbed one of her toys and gave it to each couple that was there so that they could have a toy. I don't think she expected to get them back. I'm glad she got the toys back because that would have been less toys that she had. But she was willing to give. And so the question is, how is God going to use your family? What traits do you want God to use in your family? How is he going to be able to take the brokenness that's in your family and bring about some redemption for his glory? And so as you go from this place, realize that when we see brokenness, don't let that be a discouragement, but rather let it be a time where you can be encouraged to go to God in prayer and say, God, I can't do this on my own strength. Please give me strength. Show me how you're going to use me to help raise the next generation so that they might live and walk in your ways. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Friends, a good word for us to hear, and equally we have an opportunity to declare a good word that we believe. So let us stand before the presence of a holy God and give affirmation as we read these words from Deuteronomy, reasserting that which we recognize to be true and necessary, saying together, these are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, O Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in the land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord God of the ancestors promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Oh, friends, good news for all of us. You may be seated. Well, let us come together in prayer.
Let's close our eyes and pray. Our Heavenly Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, today is the day that you've given us, a new day that has never been lived, a new confirmation of your love to our lives. Thank you for your word that has been preached unto us today. You've reminded us the institution of our families. You have also reminded us how you'd like us to live as your families. You've encouraged us to remain faithful regardless of the challenges that we are facing in our lives. You have also reminded us to live thinking of the future, for that is what you're pleased with. There is a day that you'll come, and all those that have believed in you will live in your eternity. There then, we shall no longer have the pain that we're going through in this life that we are living. You have encouraged us to walk in your way. Father, we are living in a broken world where people are facing a lot of challenges. Your word is even encouraging us that you have answers for everything. Father, in the name of Jesus, we know that the world keeps on changing, but you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Mm-hmm. Nothing is changing, and you remain the same. Mm-hmm. Help us, Lord God Almighty, to understand the situations of our lives, that no matter the turbulence in our lives, you are still God, and you never change. Mm-hmm. Help us to understand that as we're thinking of the future, each and every day that we live has to be taken as a special day where, according to your will, you can call us home so that we live to think of what will be like when we face you in your eternity. Thank you, Lord, that we have so many to pray. But you taught us that whenever we feel we are short of prayer, we can pray in this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever.
Amen.
Atate watu wakumwamba, zina lanu iletsedwe, ufumu wanu utse, kufuna kwanu kuchitidwe, monga kumwamba, chomwe cho pansipano, mudipatse ifelelo, chakuja chatu chalelo, ndipo mudikululu kile ife, zuji mwazatu. Monga ifeso, tawakululukira amanga watu. Musa titengele ife, kukati yesa, kuma mutipulu mutse ife, kwa oibayo. Chifuko wanu, ulufumu, ndimpavu, ndule merelu, wanthawi zonse. Amen.
Amen. Well, a very powerful event is for us as a church, and as you are here, Baxton, I just want to read this document that we have. It occurred to me that since you are here, this is a very opportune moment that we have as a congregation, because back in 1991, and we surmise it was the spring of 1991, that we had initiated the relationship with the Malawi Partnership, as it was once known at the very beginning. But the joy that we have as a church is to be able to renew that covenant. So as we were thinking about this, I contacted the session, and I said, this idea came over me that we need to have an official document that we have on hand here to be able to renew that covenant relationship. So it says this for us to recognize. We will, on the occasion of the International Partnership's Pilgrim Delegation visit to Pittsburgh on October 4 through October 15 in the year of our Lord 2024, and in recognition of Hampton United Presbyterian Church's initial commitment made in the spring of 1991, we, the session and congregation of Hampton United Presbyterian Church, hereby renew our covenant partnership with the International Partnership, consisting of the Synod of Blantyre of the Church of Central Africa Presbyterian in Malawi, the South Sudan Presbyterian Evangelical Church, and Pittsburgh Presbytery of the PCUSA. We hereby renew our covenant relation, our partnership with our sister congregation who gathers at St. Andrew's CCAP in Chickawawa Presbytery. We hereby renew and recognize our commitment to this covenant by providing support through prayer, involvement, and mutual financial obligation. Be it resolved on this 13th day of October in the year of our Lord Jesus Christ, 2024, by the mercy of God, that this covenant bond will be upheld in the spirit of the partnership's theme verse, Romans 1:12. Ku'ulumeraru wa walamunga, for the glory of God. I think this is good news for us and a reason to celebrate and for joy. What we have is a pen. This is a powerful story that I'm going to give to Baxton that he can take back to Africa. It's amazing how the Lord works. So this idea comes into my head that we need to have this. And I thought to myself, you know, all those important signing documents always have a pen that's involved that's connected to it. I thought, oh my gosh, I need to find a pen. So I called Rick Bennett. And Rick Bennett said, Ted, all my pens are in Ohio. But he said, hold on a minute. I think I've got something. And he said, you know, I've had this pile of wood next to my pen blanks, and I didn't know what to do with it. I wasn't really sure what it was at first, what kind of wood it was. And he said, it's just sitting there. And it always had been sitting there, and I couldn't use it for anything. It just was there. And he looked at it, and he examined it, and he said, well, wait a minute. This is olive wood from an olive tree from Israel. And he thought, and he looked at it, and he said, well, this is going to work perfectly. He said, but do I have the inside guts for the pen? He said, I'm not sure if I have the inside guts. Well, as he was thinking about that, he looked down at his collection of pen parts that he has, and there, peering out of the box, as if jumping out of the box itself, he said, there was the label coming through the lid of the box, pointing right to him, saying, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here. And so he opens up the lid of the box and pulls out the guts and says, my lands, this is amazing. Because then when you look at the actual inscriptions that on this, for this pen, designed for this wood, because he had no idea, because every pen is a little bit different. It says, faith, hope, and love. The cross that goes around the top and the Jerusalem cross at the top of this pen, which reminds us that the gospel goes out to all the directions of the compass. So we're going to use this pen to sign these documents, and you'll take this back to Africa with you, and they'll be able to sign this same document, and we'll have a copy here, and they'll have a copy at St. Andrew's, and you can even keep a copy for yourself if you'd like. But you get to keep this pen with this document as you go back to Africa to commemorate this time that we have together. So here we are together, offering all that we have before the presence of a holy God, recognizing the commitment that we have, and it's now our opportunity to return to God that which He has graciously given to us. Let us receive our tithes and offer. Thank you.
Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, all things comes from you. This life is a gift that you've given us. What shall we give back to you, Lord? And today we come with these tithes and offerings. Bless the hand that has given. Bless us all. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
As we're doing this blessing and we're speaking to each other, we're remembering God's faithfulness to the 1,000 generations. Doesn't mean we're going to be perfect in raising the next generation, but when we're saying, God, use my efforts, take what is incomplete and imperfect and help make it perfect for your ways and your will, points to that reality of the importance of the relationship we have with one another. So,
the Lord bless you and keep you.
The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you
and give you peace.